December 10th. Charity has been practicing with the kids on Sunday mornings. And so if you have a child It'd be great for you guys to make sure they are here for the next few weeks, get them practiced up, and then you're going to want to be here for that sweet time for our Christmas play, the children's Christmas play on December 10th, and that'll be in the morning service. And then our church Christmas party is at Janine's house on the 15th, starting at 5 p.m., and we'll get the details for that. That's always a special time of dinner and fun and food and fellowship. And then a new thing on the calendar, I just got the email for this week, is the men's conference that the Craigs put on. Pastor Craig and the Craig family put on a men's conference, and it is in Hinckley. It starts at 8 a.m. on December 16th. It does say the cost is $25. That's for breakfast, for lunch, and whatever cost they have. We will cover that cost if you can't pay for that. We want as many men as we can to take to the men's conference for the Craig Family Ministry. There's a sign-up table. There's a sign-up sheet at the back of the church before you go out the door. If you're interested in that, please put your name on there. If you can pay the $25, great. If you can't, that is just fine. We will take care of it. We want as many people to go to the men's conference as possible. So those are my announcements. We have no birthdays. Leroy, your birthday is next week. So we're going to sing happy birthday to Leroy. The boys' anniversary is next Sunday. And so we'll sing a happy birthday and happy anniversary to them. And then nobody is born in December. We had everybody in November. And December, we've only got Kat, Josiah, and Aziz that are celebrating birthdays in the month of December. So those are the birthdays. Did we miss any birthdays in December? Anybody else has a birthday in December that we don't have written down? I didn't think so. So Miss Vine does a great job of keeping track of that. And so thankful for her. All right, those are my announcements as far as I know them. And so let's go ahead and turn our attention to worship. And we always start our worship here with praise. And just take time every Sunday to just thank God. Now this is Thanksgiving week. Amen?
Amen.
All right, let's not lose track of what Thanksgiving week is about. It is a week, you know, some of you guys I have a whole week off, so if we say a week, for some of you it's a couple days, but whatever it is, the reason there's a holiday this week is for us as Americans to give thanks to God. And folks, we have much to be thankful for as Americans. Amen?
Amen.
I'm so thankful that God allowed me to be born in California. Lived most of my life in Bakersfield. Not a whole lot to be thankful for about Bakersfield, but California was great. God has allowed me as an American to move to Florida and enjoy life there in Florida and then come back to God's country. Now I live in Yermo, California. This is God's country. Amen?
Amen.
Beautiful, beautiful place. I love it when you go on and you see people just staring at the beauty of the desert, and we take for granted how beautiful our area is. And what beautiful weather. I looked at video last year. This was the week that I switched from wearing polos to sweaters. And I'm wearing a polo still. So it means the weather is still fairly nice. And so I'm hoping that I can still wear polos. We're going to Idaho for the week. And the whole high of the week is supposed to be like 42 degrees. And so no shorts and t-shirts there. But I praise God. I live in Yermo. I praise God for the blessings of America. I thank God for my wife and my family. I have been so blessed to be what God has blessed me with. And so I'm such a blessed person, and I'm thankful for everything that God has given me. As we're going to talk about in the service this morning, I'm thankful for the Lord. I look forward to preaching the message this morning all on God. And listen, folks, if you're here this morning and your blesser isn't blessed, you feel like there's things in your life that are off, you've come to the right place, okay? So let's start off our praise. I started off. Let's just go around the room and just tell how good God has been to us. Ben.
I have two praises.
Amen.
One is my diabetes. I've had a problem with my A1C. It was really high all the time. I just couldn't get my numbers down. And it's been like almost 18 years since I've been diabetic, and just recently, last week, I changed my medication because my numbers are still high. I just couldn't realize, so I changed it, Now they cut down my insulin, and I don't have to take medication, oral medication, in the evening. Awesome. Just in the morning. And so now my number's at 112. Today was 160. And I mean, they've just been great. I just can't imagine. I'm amazed.
Amen. Praise God. That's support. Absolutely. And you said you had two.
Yeah, and the second one was my friend Mario. He's healed. He's out of the hospital. He's doing well. He's just great right now. And I'm just thankful for the Lord and what he's done for me and him.
Amen. So we have to take off that prayer request this morning. On the prayer sheet, answer to prayer. Mario Mendoza is doing well. Amen. Prayer works. Anybody else know that God's good? Miss Janine.
Okay. Yes. I have a praise. My son gave me an early Christmas present. So I now have two brand new roofs on my two guest house buildings. It's brand new, and Adrian and Ben put them up for me.
Wow. Amen.
Yes. Nice.
Amen. That's awesome. Praise
God. So I'm blessed for being alive. I'm blessed for my kids. And I'm blessed for the friends that I have.
Amen.
Everybody.
Amen. We praise God for Darren and her son. Yesterday we pulled up and we're expecting to get 20 the baskets of food for Thanksgiving. We brought the turkeys. They provided the baskets. But then he gave us a whole bunch of eggs. And so if you need eggs, there's a stack of eggs right outside before you got the door. And there's also a stack of eggs in the refrigerator. If you need eggs, take as many eggs as you can. Uh-huh. And then he donated 8 turkeys as well.
Awesome.
That's why we have an abundance of turkeys, is he gave us 8 turkeys. And then we're just so thankful for Desert Manna and your son and your Lord's blessing. Praise God. Amen. Anybody else that God did? Right in the line, there's Carol.
I praise the Lord for this church and everything that they do for everybody. I praise the Lord for the hearts of the people in this church, that they are so welcoming and so giving to everybody, and that we are able to help out our community. I praise the Lord that I got a job. I praise the Lord that I'm working on getting my car registered. I'm going to have the money to do that now. And, you know, Ethan's birthday was yesterday. It was a blessing. Yvonne's 2-year anniversary with her boyfriend was also yesterday. That was a blessing. And it's just been basically a wonderful week.
Amen.
We want to thank you and Charity for being
here.
Such a blessing to our church.
After church, we're going to have you film a commercial.
On this long list.
Amen. Praise God. Anybody else something God did for you? Yes, ma'am.
I'm just grateful for our good new friends and neighbors and our church family here, and the fact that my husband is here with us and he came back. So we're very, very blessed. We've been away for a long time. So.
Amen. Praise God for that. What a blessing. Anybody else something God did for you? Donnie.
I got two things. I thank the Lord for, I was having pain in my left leg connected to my hip, and I had people pray for me, and the pain went away. Mm-hmm. That's my first one. My second one is that I have food on the table, I have a car, my bills are paid. What more can you ask for?
Amen. Amen. No bills, no pills.
No bills, no pills. Yeah. No pills.
Amen, Tom. Someone else's hand I saw? Rain?
Yeah, I made it today. Yay.
That's our blessing. We praise God that you made it today. That's our praise, that Rain gets to be at church with us this morning. So it's so good to see you. Rain, and we've been praying so much for you. Any update on that or still?
Oh, man. There's a lot. But so throughout the past year, I've gotten a whole list of things wrong with me. Should probably go to the doctor regularly, I was told I was going blind, which, praise the Lord, that's not happening. My doctor is just kind of crazy, I guess. I have a prolapsed mitral valve in my heart, so my heart's kind of weak. I have a atrial venous malformation in the right side of my brain. So I have a huge vein running from the whole side of the right side of my brain, which is causing a lot of my issues. Then they found a tumor in my brain, so there's that as well. But in the face of all of that, all of those challenges, I'm still here, you know, doing good. And I've only broke down once about it, but the Lord has comforted me through all of this, and I'm like very grateful that I have that.
Amen. And I know you told Cherry, you're just trusting God's going to get rid of it.
Yeah.
Amen. And that's our prayer too, that it just go away. Mm-hmm. We have faith as well. Thank you, Rain, for being here, and praise God for that. Amen. Ms. Gail?
I want to give thanks for my husband. He's
Amen.
Amazing, but that's my opinion. And for family, especially this time of year, to be able to be with them. And for my church family and the church, I just love y'all so much.
We love you all too. Praise God for you guys getting to be here. Amen. Honey babe?
I just ditto what Donnie said, just provisions that, you know, we may not have in the world standards a lot, but God takes care of his children, and we have what we need. We have a car, we have food, we have a house, we have, you know, clothes, and not dumpy stuff either. You know, God just takes care of us, and I think thankful for that. And I'm thankful for community, just friends to do life with. And you know, yesterday you just got to sit and talk with Jen, and I just love that so much. Just do life together. So I'm so thankful.
Amen. Praise the Lord. Christine?
I have faith that our brother decided to become a member of the church.
Say that again.
I said I am just blessed that he decided to become a member of our church.
Chester, for joining the church.
Yep.
Amen. So you're going to have to stay after service today, Chester, so we could vote on that. All right. Bob?
Thankful for being able to live in this great country.
Amen.
And for my wife.
Amen. America, the land of the beautiful, and your wife is beautiful. Praise God, right?
Yes.
Amen. My wife learned how to cook meatloaf yesterday, so I can't tell you how happy that makes me. I gave her a big old kiss and said, thank you, honey, that was delicious. Anybody else something to be thankful for? Miss Cindy.
Well, this is sort of for both Dave and I know he'll agree with that, is that, you know, the beginning of the year sort of started off rocky for us because he was having all that chest pain and he wasn't sure what was going on with heartburn. You know, you just don't know what it really is, but he finally stepped forward and said, I need to go to the doctor. And that's when they found out that he almost had to have a 5 bypass, but he only ended up with 4. And they also did a little bit on his lung, and, you know, that was a lot. He doesn't remember what I remember, what he went through, and when I saw him come out of, you know, surgery and everything, and it was very disturbing, to be honest with you. And the Lord was there with me, and the Lord pulled him through and had him at the, you know, everything just worked out, you know, worked out. I mean, he didn't have much time between the time that he was diagnosed to the time that he actually had to have that surgery, so it was pretty major, but praise that he made it, and thank you for all the doctors and all the prayers that everybody did for us this year. And it wasn't just a one-day thing. It, you know, lasted quite a long time.
Amen. Praise God for healing and recovery and hospitals. And awesome. Yeah. Praise God. Ms. Carol?
I just praise the Lord for the health I have. You know, you moan and you groan, but it's like, praise the Lord that you can get around. Every day.
Amen. Moaning and groaning, and God is still good. Yes. Stephanie.
I just like praise the Lord that like I had a good like couple of days of like for the first time that I like ever worked.
How you enjoy work?
It's like really, really chill, and it's not really a strain on you, so It's just really, really fast paced, and it's just really, really good.
Do you get to watch the movies?
No.
No? She got a job at the movie theater at Port Irwin, so that was my question. You get to see the movies for free, so. Amen. That's awesome. It's good to have a chill job. Oh, yes. Praise God for that. Folks, once again, I just remind you, please, this week, would you spend time thinking about how good God has been to you. Whatever you're down and depressed and discouraged about, that is of Satan. Satan wants you to focus on your problems. You know, the saying goes, Satan wants you to take a microscope to the problems you have and make those a big deal. Okay? God wants you to take a telescope and look up and see how good He is. And so stop looking down and discouraged and defeated at all the troubles and trials of this life, and just lift your head up and look at God and see how good He's been to your life. And listen, if you say, well, He's not been very good to me, well, listen, we're going to talk about this morning. He may not have been so good as you think He is, but He is a good, good Father, as we sang last Sunday. He is so good. And He is so wonderful, and He's so powerful. And if you give your life to Him, I promise you, you will not regret it. Amen. Your life will improve by tenfold, and you begin to see the goodness of God.
Amen.
So thankful for what He's done. So we'll go ahead and flip to our prayer requests. And before we get to prayer requests, we have a couple folks to help take the offering. All right, Savvy and Ben. We'll have Savvy. Let's just wait a minute till we pray. Wait till we pray. We pray first. I know you're so anxious to get the offering. Amen. He's like, I gotta get that right now. Chill, bro. Chill. Okay. We're gonna go ahead and pray first, and then we're gonna ask the Lord to take up the offering. And so, prayer request this morning mentioned in Sunday school. Please, if you have your prayer sheet, which I hope you do, if you don't, it's on the back table back there. Grab one. We took away the Meeks family from Bonnie's, but the Carey family right next to that is the family that. The 12-year-old girl that passed away, their memorial service is next Sunday, so they really need prayer this week. Actually, my friend, Pastor Brock in Ironwood, is going to be leading that service. She's a Newberry resident, and so glad to hear that this week, that they have a pastor friend to connect with them and minister to their family. Kristen Debbie Fogart is Carol's sister and brother-in-law, and they need lots of prayer this week. Also, Carol, myself, and hopefully Miss Jana are traveling out of town for a bit. We appreciate your prayers for us. Peggy Obaldo asked us to add her daughter Colleen, Jana for her ankle so she could drive and travel. And then Kat added her sister Stephanie. It just says she's not doing well. And Ben asked us to pray to put his foot down. There's a wound on his foot that's not healing so well. So appreciate your prayers for that. Anybody else, something we missed, we can put on the prayer sheet. Carol?
My sister found out she has CHF, congestive heart failure. And
what's her name?
Kathy.
Kathy. So Kathy K or C?
C-A-T-H-I. Reshti. Okay. Go ahead. Go ahead, spell it.
Reshti? No, I've got it. Okay.
But yeah, she found out that she has CHF. My father just passed away this past June. And she's been going to therapy, congestive heart failure therapy. So we're hoping that that will help her. And we also want to pray for her girlfriend, Donnie. D-A-W-N-E-E. She has gout in both her feet and is also having congestive heart failure.
So Kathy with an I and then Donnie.
With an I.
With an I, okay. Yes. As well. We'll be praying, absolutely.
Thank you.
Anything else we can ask the prayer sheet to pray for? Donnie?
My brother David has AFib. It's a heart condition.
I missed his name. Davey?
David.
David, okay. David for heart problems as well?
Yeah, AFib it's called.
Same thing.
Yeah.
Kind of. Same.
Or I'll add David to your prayer sheet. And your sister Joyce on there. Yes. Fred.
Well, I'm here. Just My nephew is in prison right now. I remember him as a kid, but he's an adult now. But he's in prison. He's great for all the prisoners. He's great. Okay. Get along with other prisoners and things like that. Yes.
Absolutely. God cares for those in jail. One of the things he said, those that will go into the jails and visit them. And we absolutely should be praying for them. I had the privilege of going to jail a couple times and preaching with folks. You'll never have a more captive audience. Those men and women, both, just glean. That's all they have. They don't have nothing but time. And so when they get someone who's interested in the Bible, they listen and they study. And so absolutely we should be praying for those in jail. God can open their hearts. And that people would go and send to the prisons to preach the Bible. Anything else we can pray for this week? All right, let's go ahead and go to the Lord in prayer and spend a few minutes praying. So Lord, as I pray aloud, pray for these requests. Ask God whatever's on your heart. Of course, get your heart ready as we're going to begin worship here in just a few minutes. Confessing your sins and asking God to just speak the Spirit of God and give us a great time of worship this morning. Let's pray. God, we love you. We thank you for this day. Thank you for this chance we have as Americans to step some, to take some time and focus on the blessings. And Lord, we really should make Thanksgiving every day. Lord, it'd be so good for our spirits, so good for our country, so good for our families, Lord, to just get together on a regular basis and just take time to talk about the blessings. Lord, that is not what our country does. Our country takes time to divide families. They want to destroy and bring in the bad news and just discourage us and depress us. And Lord, that's what we have most of the time. Lord, pray it'll be a breath of fresh air this week. Lord, we turn off the news. We stop talking bad about our neighbors and stop talking bad about our family members. And God, we truly have a sense of revival in our lives of joy and praise and thanksgiving together. Lord, that we come together as a nation to just praise God for his goodness. Lord, we are so blessed as Americans. Lord, we have so much to be thankful for. We have so much in common, God. And Lord, yet we look at the small things and we argue and fight over them. And Lord, rather than loving our neighbor, Lord, we are critical of them and criticize everything. God, that is not godly. That is so of Satan. Mm-hmm. Satan wants us to complain. He wants us to moan. He wants us to groan. He wants us to be discouraged. God, you want us to praise. And Lord, we're so thankful that we have a week of praise. Help us, Lord, to spend every moment we have this week available to spend in prayer, to spend in praise. May we call a family member or a neighbor and just let them know how much we're thankful for them, or our boss or employee, and just let everyone know that we're thankful for them. Lord, may we just lift up our spirits and may it be a great week. Thank you for the answers to prayer. Thank you for taking care of Mario Mendoza. Lord, strengthening Ben with his diabetes. For taking care of Dave. Father, thankful for Stephanie's job and being chill. Lord, thankful for our country. Lord, thank you for Janine's roof. Lord, we're thankful for Desert Manna as they were blessing us as well. And thankful for Yermo, for Jen, and for her husband moving back. And Donnie's thankful for healing in his life and the power of prayer. God, we're so thankful for Randy to be here this morning. What a blessing that is. Gail for her husband, and Father for her family and church. I just thank you for Charity, for the provision, and for community. And Lord, we're so thankful for Christine as Chester joined the church today. And Lord, just so thankful for the blessings that you've blessed our church and answers to prayer. And Lord, we pray today that you just be with these requests. Lord, heal and help these folks. Lord, just help our church to fulfill our mission. Lord, help us today as we worship you that, Lord, you'd show up, you'd speak to our hearts, that it wouldn't just be a normal church service. God, it'd be an extraordinary church service because God showed up, because we learned from the word, because our faiths were strengthened. Lord, that even souls would be saved this morning. Hallelujah, praise God. Just give us a great day of worship. Praying for our building, for our parsonage fund. Lord, pray for wisdom as we plan the budget out here in a few minutes. Lord, that you help us have unity together to agree with what we could do next year for you. Lord, bless our nation, for our leaders, our troops. Lord, pray for churches all across the nation. Think of our valley here. Lord, pray for Pastor Chris and Yermo Bible Church. Father, pray for Lord Pastor Anthony and their church over there, Pastor Brock and Lord, for pastor there in Barstow, for Pastor Newberry Community Church and Pastor Ray and their ministry. So thankful for them. And Lord, just bless these churches in our area and Lord, all across the land. May the Spirit of God move and may we see revival across these churches. Pray for our missionaries and for the folks around the world. Miss Shides, Miss Judy, and Charlene, take care of these dear ladies. Pray for Carol as she travels this week, and her sister Chris and Debbie, that you just be with them. And Lord, praying for Bonnie and for her request for Carrie family, comfort them. And I'll pray for my friend Pastor Brock as he ministers to them this week, that the encouragement and get the gospel to them. Pray for the Boyd family, and Lord, help Carol with these jobs, and for her sister Kathy and Donnie for healing. For my family as we travel, and Lord, charity's request for Joe Pasola, that you just heal this dear man, and for Peggy Obaldo's daughter Colleen, Miss Jana, that you allow her ankle to heal so she could travel, and Lord, give her safety, and Lord, her friend Rebecca Shirley here in town, Lord, needs lots of prayer. Lord, you just be with her, and Cindy's friends, Marissa, Rosia, and Brittany, that you heal their bodies, and Rain, Lord, just take this tumor, this mass on her brain away, that you just be healed. For Aunt Tina, Miss Sandy and Greg this morning, strength and healing in their lives. And Father, for Richard, Miss Vita's health, and for Loretta. And we're praying for these friends of hers with cancer for healing. Miss Tom and Candy and Matt. And we'll just take care of Charlotte and their family today. And we'll just continue to be with Bob and Gail as they travel. And granddaughter Ashley, praying for this house, Lord, to get built. Kat for her family and travel safety. And for her sister Stephanie, for Donnie's nephew. And Lord, I pray you just watch over for Donnie's brother and Lord, his friend's nephew in jail, that you just be with them. Father, pray for Tay, his request for Vanessa and his mom as she's traveling. Ben, for healing for his foot. And Lord, pray for these unspoken requests from Alan, Leroy, Kat, Donnie, and Tom, that you intervene for these requests. Lord, finally, we pray for our missionaries. Be with each and every one of them that are in foreign countries preaching the gospel now, especially people of Bullocks in Spain, Case in Mexico, the Bundys in Ethiopia, the Hazards in the Dominican Republic, the Denise's in the Philippines, the Craig family, plus the Burnett family in Haiti, Mission Dignity, Camp Ironwood, the Kim and Yap families as they start these churches in L.A., Caleb McCullough, Lord, be with him as he gets the support to get to Germany. And the Lord, just pray for those that are preaching the gospel right now in foreign languages. Give them power. Lord, may we see revival, not just in our nation, but all across the world. Would you send laborers? Lord, thank you for this time of prayer. I pray for this offering we're about to receive. Thank you for those that give so faithfully. And the Lord, just continue to help us to use this money to glorify you, to help our community. And the Lord will thank you for what you can do. In Jesus' name we ask. Amen. Savvy and Ben, thank you.
Oh,
couple Christmas songs. And I'm looking forward to that. Thank you.
All right, good morning, Silver Valley Church.
Good morning.
How you guys doing today?
Good.
We're gonna get the Christmas spirit, even though it's not even Thanksgiving yet, but we're gonna do some Christmas songs, and we're gonna do The Little Drummer Boy. You ready? All right, this is a little drummer. We don't have a drummer, per se.
Looking for one.
Hopefully we will. Soon. All right, this one. That's
Donnie and Stephanie for leading us in worship, and it's always good to sing Christmas songs. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
And I hope you've got some more prepared for us, Donnie. You got more Christmas songs than that?
Probably.
Probably.
We've got a few in his repertoire.
We've got a few days.
All right. We'll go ahead and sing our children's chorus this morning. Everybody stand. As you see, he's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. This is a clapping song. So get your clappers out. Ready? He's got
the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got the wind and the rain
in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the wind and the rain in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got
the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the little bitty baby in his hands. He's got the whole world in his hands.
He's got
you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got you and me, brother. In his hands, he's got the whole world in his hands.
All right. Young people, you guys be dismissed. Children for Children's Church. The rest of you guys have a seat and settle in for a few minutes as we study the Trinity in Revelation. The Trinity in Revelation. You say, Pastor Cody, I thought we finished the book of Revelation. I lied to you. I'm sorry. No, I really was finished. And then last week, I wasn't even going to preach last week. I was just going to let the whole service be an anniversary Sunday. But as I told you, my wife was like, well, if you don't preach, I can't have my class and I can't preach to them. So, all right, I preached. And Lord willing, I believe that I preached the most important message I will ever preach at Silver Valley Baptist Church last Sunday, as we gave the vision to make his mission, which is on the wall here, we say it's our mission, it's his mission, to our passion, that we would passionately desire to serve and honor God as he wants to be served and honored. And so last week we talked about church, and then that was in Revelation chapter 1, 2, and 3. This week, I was preparing to preach a Thanksgiving sermon, and then it just dawned on me. It was like, you had a sermon that you were going to preach in the middle of the book of Revelation that I didn't get to preach because I took too long on one of the other sermons. So I was like, I think that is a great sermon to preach before Thanksgiving. And so the title of the sermon today is The Trinity in Revelation. And to study it, we're going to read the book of Psalms. Does it make sense, Cody? Not a lot of what I say does make sense, so just be patient with me. But folks, we're really just looking at God today. I said last week was probably the most important message I will ever preach here at church. This sermon that I'm going to preach this morning is my favorite sermon I will ever preach at this church. And I think it'll be your favorite sermon as well. And I look forward to talking about God this morning. We've spent a lot of time the last few weeks talking about Satan. It's time to talk about God. And let's go ahead, and I know we haven't been doing this the last few weeks, but maybe we get back to the habit of this. Let's stand, if you're able to, as we read this passage of praise to God in Psalm 145, out of reverence and respect for God. Remember, the very first thing that God desires in our worship is that it be reverence. We have a love for God in our hearts and lives. So let's reverence God's word this morning as we read Psalm 145. I will extol thee, my God, O King. I will bless thy name forever and ever. Every day will I bless thee. I will praise thy name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall praise thy works to another, and shall declare thy mighty acts. I will speak of the glorious honor of thy majesty and of thy wondrous works, and men shall speak of the might of thy terrible acts, and I will declare thy greatness. They shall abundantly utter the memory of thy great goodness and shall sing of thy righteousness. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion, slow to mercy, and the Lord is good to all, and his tender mercies over all his works. All thy works shall praise thee, O Lord, and bless thy saints thee. They shall speak of the glory and thy kingdom and talk of thy power, to make known the sons of men his mighty acts and the glorious majesty of his kingdom. Thy kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and thy dominion endureth throughout all generations. The Lord upholdeth all those that fall and raiseth up all those that are bowed down. The eyes of all wait upon thee, and thou givest them their meat in due season. Thou openest thine hand and satisfiest the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways, and holy in all his works. The Lord is nigh unto all them that call upon him, to all that will call upon him in truth. He will fulfill the desire of them that fear him. He also will hear their cry and will save them. The Lord preserveth all that love him, but all the wicked will he destroy. My mouth shall speak the praise of the Lord, and let all the flesh bless his holy name forever and ever. Let's pray. God, thank you for the chance to study this morning about you. And Lord, what a wonderful passage to get into this morning. As David just praised God for who you are. And Lord, may we begin to get our hearts and our eyes and minds on you, and off of our problems and off of our whatever's going on in our life, God, when we get our eyes onto you this week and just give you praise and glory for your goodness. Bless us, as we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Be seated. Let me ask you this question before we get started. What do you think the person who wrote this psalm got excited about?
The Lord.
What?
The Lord.
The Lord, right? It's a trick question. No, it's not a trick question, all right? This guy sat down and he says, hey, I'm going to list the things that I am thankful for. He took a time of Thanksgiving, and he was like, I'm going to be thankful for God, and I'm going to thank him for this, and I'm going to thank him for that, and I'm going to thankful that he is this, and I'm going to thankful that he's given me this. And he just started talking about how good God is, and he just kept talking and talking and talking. You know, some of you have been around people that do that, right? They just keep talking and talking and talking, and you're like, I heard this before. Please, would you just let me go? Listen, that's this guy, all right? This is the guy that grabbed you by the shirt and said, hey, have I told you how good God is today? Have I told you what he's done for me in my life? Yes, you told me last week. Let me tell you again. Let me tell you again. And that's his passion. Many of you have a passion. You have something in your life that you could talk a lot about. You know, everyone is different. For some, it's, you know, a TV show. For some of you, it's a sports team. For some of you, it's cooking. For some of you, you know, anime. For some of you, it could be anything. You know, listen to things. You know, you could get down and you could begin to talk about that subject for a while. But folks, this is a chance for us this week to give thanks for God. My prayer and God's prayer, and I promise you, to be one of the most profitable things you could do this week, is to just begin to put your heart on the Lord. I read through this passage of scripture very quickly. You know, truthfully, I could have just taken my time and just slowly go through this passage about all the things God has done and God is. And that could be our sermon. But like I said, I wanted to get to Revelation. And my thought this morning is this, okay? Some of you this morning, look at this thing. It says, give thanks for all the Lord has done. And your thought right now could be, I don't have much to give thanks to God. He sure hasn't done much for me lately. That could be your heart. Okay? Let me just tell you, I've been there. Okay? I've been there at a point in my life where I had very little to thank God for. All I could think about was what I didn't have. All I could think about was how terrible things were in my life. And I was at the point where I wanted to just die. Maybe that's where you're at today. You just think you're at the end of your rope and have nothing to be thankful for. And folks, if that's you this morning, you've come to the right place. Because this morning we're not talking about the good things that are happening in your life. We're talking about the goodness of the Lord. This says, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good. This morning I want us to give thanks for the Lord. Just giving thanks for who God is. You may not see the goodness of God today, But as we walk through the passages of Revelation, you begin to see how great, how glorious, how gracious, how giving, how wondrous, how holy, how happy, how blessed you are to have a God that loves you. Nobody on this earth may love you, but I promise you this today with every fiber of my being, He loves you. Deeply. Well, how do I know that He loves me? Well, we can just look at the cross. And we know that He loved you so much that He died for your sins. And folks, we're going to look at the Trinity this morning. God, the Son, and the Spirit in Revelation. The Trinity, and maybe some of you are not aware of what the Trinity is. We sing it in our song this morning. Holy, 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 Lord God Almighty. We talk about the Father, the Son, the Spirit, the Holy Trinity. Here's the symbol of the Trinity, and it's a symbol of lines that seem like they're three different symbols, but combined they make one symbol. And that's what the Trinity is. John chapter 1, 5 and 6 says this: "This is He that came by water and blood, even Jesus. Not by water only, but by the blood, and it is the Spirit that beareth witness, because the Spirit is truth. For there are three that bear record in heaven: the Father, the Word, which is Jesus, and the Holy Ghost. And these three are
one."
One. The Trinity is a very difficult thing to understand. Okay? The easiest way that I can compare the Trinity is to compare it to you. Alright? A doctor, a philosopher, will look at you and say, you are body, you are soul, and you are spirit. Your body is what we see. Your soul is who you are. And your spirit is your feelings, it's your emotions, how you know you exist. I have feelings. I have a rage, or I have joy. Are you three different beings? You are what?
One.
One. I am Marvin Cody Frazier. But in Marvin Cody Frazier, there is my body that you see, this ugly thing standing in front of you, okay? But inside, there's a pretty thing called my soul, all right? The outside is not very good to look on, but I believe in my heart that I have a good soul. That's who I am on the inside, right? Aren't you glad we have a soul?
Yes.
You know, our outside can't fix it, but man, who we are on the inside, we sure can. And then there's our spirit, that part that feels, that knows we're alive, right? Three distinct parts of me, yet I am what?
One.
One. God the Father is the soul. Jesus the Son is like the body. And then the Spirit is, of course, the Spirit, the one that moves, that works. And God is a Father on the throne. And His Son, in physical form, sits next to Him. And the Spirit of God is working and moving in the whole creation, as we're going to talk about this morning. Well, who is God? Which one is God? He's all God. Jesus says He was God. God says He's God. The Spirit's called the Spirit of God. All three are one being in three different forms. And I hope that makes sense this morning, that we only have one God. They're just in three different forms. And they have three different purposes. But still, one God, Jehovah, the Lord God Almighty. And so we're going to walk through the book of Revelation. And I read the book of Revelation, and I found every mention of Jesus, of God, and of the Spirit. Now, I'm not going to mention every one of them, because some of them are the same. We're going to look about who is God in Revelation. Now, let me just say this before we get started, okay? This is just, see this book right here?
Mm-hmm.
This is called the story of God. Mm-hmm. The Bible is God's story. It's who God is. And this evening, this morning, I'm going to read to you this part. I went and I looked through the book of Revelation. I found who God was in this. Do you see that? That's it. Compare that to this.
Mm-hmm.
You see? What I'm talking about this morning is a sliver of a sliver of a sliver of God's story and who God is. And folks, if you're confused about God, or you're discouraged, or whatever it is in your life, just begin to walk through this book. And you'll see God. And you'll see what he does. And you'll see his love. And you'll feel his power. And it'll begin to encourage and strengthen and uplift you. I encourage you this week not to go to the book of Revelation. I encourage you this week to go to the book of Psalms. And just sit down when you have a chance and read Psalm 100. Read Psalm 95. Read Psalm 145 as we read this morning. These are psalms of praise, of thanksgiving to God. And maybe if you have a chance, I remember when I was a kid, and my aunt came out once one Christmas, and she said, I want to read the Christmas story. And everyone around said, we don't want to hear that. We don't want to hear that story. And they booed her, and then she was hurt. She couldn't read the Christmas story one time during Christmas. Maybe you need to be that aunt this week, or that uncle, or that grandma, or that grandpa, or the father, the son, whoever it is, and say, hey, it's Thanksgiving. I know we may not be comfortable with this, but I'm going to read Psalm 100. And I just want to get our attention on God and his goodness this week. And they may boo you, and they may nay you, and they may do what they did to my aunt, say, we don't want to hear anything about God and the Bible. Get that junk out of here. Okay, I'd rather you face that persecution than start talking about politics, okay? Because that's nonsense. That doesn't need to be talked about at all. But this, absolutely 100%, should be our focus this week, is talking about God. I promise you, you start talking about God, it'll change the politics. You realize Republican Democrats are garbage. It's him, and it's all about who he is. And when we get to God, we see what? We see unity. We see togetherness. America doesn't need us to sit and talk about politics this week. America needs to sit around and talk about God and his goodness and his love and his provision. And all of that stupid garbage politics will begin to just settle down. And you'll get your eyes on Jesus and his goodness this week. And so if you have a chance, just spend some time looking at who God is. And so let's look at the book of Revelation. Once again, it's a sliver of a sliver of a sliver of a sliver of what God is. Revelation chapter 1, verse 5. And Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness, the first begotten of the dead, the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. Jesus is first in this passage called the faithful witness. Who's he the witness of? He's a faithful witness of who?
God. Christ.
The Bible says, God sent him to this earth to be born of Mary the Virgin so that he could come tell the world who his Father is. And all Jesus talked about was the truth of who God is. Mm-hmm. And what God wants and what God says. He was a faithful witness. Folks, how are you on being a faithful witness of God? The only way you're ever going to become a faithful witness of God is by reading this book. Not by listening to Pastor Cody. Not by listening to YouTube preachers. Not by some book you read about God. No, you want to be a faithful witness of God. Read God's Word. And be a faithful witness of who God is. Number two, he was first begotten of the dead. That talks about the resurrection. What does that mean, Pastor Cody? Well, that's a good thing you asked that question. That means that when Jesus died, he didn't stay dead. He arose and he's alive today. And it says he was the first. Well, who's the second? Well, the thief on the cross, probably. Who's the third? Whoever was saved. And you today can be the 10 millionth one that is the resurrected of the dead. You are a believer in Jesus. When you die, you're not going to hell. You're going to heaven. You are resurrected to a life of eternity in heaven. It says that Jesus is the prince of the kings of this earth. America doesn't need a Republican or Democrat. America needs Jesus.
Yes.
In the throne, on the leadership. That's my prayer. God, just get rid of all of this politics and just put godly men and women in our nation who love God, who love people, who want to honor God, and who want to help people. That's what we need. Because he is the prince of the kings of the earth. He's ultimately in charge. And he's the one that's moving. And we pray and ask God to give us godly leaders. It says that Jesus loved us. It says he loved us. How do we know he loved us? Well, he gave his life for us. Amen? Every day you wake up and you don't feel loved. You don't feel appreciated. Just look at the cross. And remind you that somebody loved you. Somebody loved you enough to give their life for you. And because he loved us, it says what? It washed us from our sin. It washed us from our sin. His love cleanses us from our sin so we can be forgiven, so that we can be holy, so we can be justified, redeemed, and have a home in heaven forevermore. Without Jesus, that's impossible. Next passage of scripture, Revelation 3:7. And to the angel of the church of Philadelphia, write these things, saith he that is holy, he that is true. Jesus, the Father, the Spirit, they are holy, and they are true. Holy, righteous. I mean, there's no sin. There's nothing that you can accuse God of. He is holy, and he is true. Meaning that what he says is fact. You can't argue with it. Okay? You can't debate the truth. Everybody likes to think they have the what? Truth. I have the truth. No, I have the truth. I saw the truth. No, you saw the truth. The fact of the matter is, folks, we are not perfect beings. We don't know the truth because he is the one that is the true one. He has the truth. Folks, I hope and pray today. Maybe you're in this room this morning. And someone's lied about you. Someone slandered you. Someone has put you down. At the end of the day, you know what? He knows the truth. Amen?
Amen.
And the Bible says he's going to take care of it. So if you've been lied at, you've been slandered about, you've been put down by something that wasn't right, just know he's the God of truth. He knows the truth, and the truth is going to set me free. Folks, he is holy, he is true. Next one, Revelation 5:12. Say with loud voice, worthy is the Lamb that was slain to receive power and riches and wisdom and strength and honor and glory and blessings. Jesus in the Bible over and over again is referred to as the Lamb. The Lamb. What does that mean, Pastor Cody, the Lamb? Well, in the Old Testament, when they wanted redemption from their sins, they would go to the temple and they would offer a lamb. And that lamb gave its life for the redemption of that person that offered that. Jesus was born as the Lamb. He was given by God for the sins of the whole world. And many people, that's where they see Jesus as the Lamb. Oh, he's just a cute little lamb that was slain for our sins. Well, he's not just the Lamb. He is the Elder saith to him, weep not, behold the Lion of the tribe of Judah. The root of David hath prevailed, open the book and loose the seven seals. Jesus isn't just the Lamb this morning, folks. He is the Lion. And some folks need Jesus, the Lion, the Lamb today to comfort them. Some of us need Jesus, the Lion today to overcome, to strengthen us, to be with us, to fight for us. Jesus is the Lamb, but he's also, folks, the Lion. I found the song this week. He's the Lion and the Lamb. I want to say the author. Do you know who sang that song, Donnie? The Lion and the Lamb?
I think it was Chris Tomlin.
Tomlin or Weave? Big Daddy Weave?
Big Daddy Weave, yeah.
Is that his name?
Yeah.
I encourage you to go listen to that song. The Lion and the Lamb. It was a sweet song to listen to about his comfort, but at the same time, he is also in control. And he can strengthen. He can succor those who are needing weakness. But he's also the root of David. This is a promise to Israel, to the Jews. David was the king of the Jews. And God said, your lineage will always be, there will always be a king on the throne of Israel. And we know that today there is no king of Israel. Well, listen, Jesus is the king of Israel today. And he still loves, and he's still on the throne leading Israel. And one day he will lead Israel back to the promised land. And folks, we're thankful that he is the root of David. We pray for our brothers and sisters that are lost in Israel, that they would receive the gospel to believe in Jesus, the root of David. Revelation 12:5, and she brought forth a man-child who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron, and her child was caught up to God and to his throne. This is talking about the Christmas story. She, being Mary, gave birth to a man. Jesus isn't just God. Jesus was also man. He was in physical form. What does that mean, Pastor Cody? Well, that means he knows what you're going through right now. He knows how tough it is to be an adult. He knows what it's like to be betrayed, to be backstabbed. He knows what it's like to be lied about. He knows what it's like to be in a room of people who don't like him. And yet he did what was right all day, every day. Nobody can be holy, nobody can be perfect except for God. But folks, let me just tell you, he was man and he was God. And he lived a perfect life that honored and pleased God. And folks, today, may you begin to look to Jesus and say, how can I live a holy and just life as a man, as a woman? And understand it is possible, but it's going to take a lot of renewal, taking away the garbage, and then getting slowly to add the good. It's taken me 38 years old. I got saved when I was 16, almost 30 years, 20 plus years. And I'm still working on it, folks. I still fail, I still fall every day. But you know what? My desire is that I be more like a man of God and less like a man of this world. And daily after day after day, trying to be more like Jesus. And folks, as we look through these titles today and we see who God is, I want you to understand something. God wants us to be, the word is godly. What does godly mean? Godly means like God. I could never be like God. No, you're right, you can't. But we certainly should set the bar up that we want to be what?
Like God.
Godly. That's the bar. The bar's not, well, I wish I could be like Pastor Cody or Miss Charity or Miss Janine or Alan. You know, that's the bar. I wish I could be like them. No, that's not the bar. Mm-hmm. Right, Alan? You don't want to be like us, do you? No, you want to be like Christ. That's the bar.
Yeah.
Godliness. So he was the man child, he was just like you and me. But listen, he was the lamb, he was the lion, he was the man. And now we're going to see the next one. He was in 17:14. These make war with the lamb, and the lamb shall overcome them, for he is the Lord of lords and the King of kings. King of kings and Lord of lords. That's the title that has on him as he's coming down in the book of Revelation to fight the battle there, Armageddon. He is the King of kings and the Lord of lords. He is supreme. He reigns. He rules. He has all power. And that's the God we serve today. 19:13. He was clothed with vesture dipped in blood. And this is his name, called the Word of God. Jesus is the Word of God. John chapter 1, verse 1. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God. And the Word was God. Folks, he is the Word of God. This book that we have is Jesus. Jesus is in this book. Mm-hmm. He gives us the power through his word. Chapter 22, one of my favorites. Jesus, have I sent my angel to testify unto you these things to the churches. I am the root, the offspring of David, and the bright morning star. I love that name of Jesus. The bright and morning star. That's just talking about, folks, that he is the light of this world. He will be the light in eternity. When all hope is lost, when it seems like darkness is around, we can look up and we can see Jesus, the bright and morning star. I know that there is hope, and there is a God that loves me, and I can look to him, and he can shine on me, and I can have that joy, I can have that strength, I can have that healing, because he is the bright and morning star. Let's talk about God. God the Father, the one that's on the throne, the essence here. It says, I, God, am the Alpha, the Omega, the beginning and the ending. Saith the Lord, which is, and which was, which is to come, the Almighty. So lots in here. Alpha and Omega, what does that mean?
Beginning and the end.
Okay, he was in the beginning, Alpha, beginning, the first letter of the Greek alphabet, and Omega, which is the last letter of the Greek alphabet. We would say today, as English, he is the A to the Z. All right? He is the beginning and he is the end. Now, we know there is no end. It's infinitely going on. But he was there in the beginning. And not only is he the beginning and the end, but he is what? Who is just now, who was yesterday, and he is tomorrow. Meaning God is not just some God who created the world and then left it for us to just have chaos. No, he is. Yesterday he was there, he's there today, and he's going to be there when?
Tomorrow.
The sun will come up tomorrow, and if it doesn't, we know that he's going to be there. The sun may not come up, but listen, we know that he is going to be there. And that word there, the Almighty! Almighty God, meaning there is all power. The word we like to use is omnipotent, meaning there is nothing too hard for God. He can move a mountain with his thumb. He could heal. He can bless. Listen, folks, here is nothing too hard for God. And I hope and pray this morning that if you get anything out of this message, that you'll remember that God is Almighty. There's nothing too hard for God. And whatever it is you need, he can take care of. Verse 4. Chapter 4, verse 11. Thou art worthy, O Lord, to receive glory, amen, honor, and power. For thou hast created all things, and for thy pleasure they are and were created. He is the creator. He is the one that put it all together and put it in its place. And he made you, and he formed you just how he wanted to do. And he is the one that put you where he put you. And he is going to take care of you because he is a good, good father. He's not just the creator, but he is the what? Father. He's a good father. He created you, he put you on this earth, and he's going to take care of you as he says. He is. And the angel thrust his sickle in the earth and gathered the vine of the earth and cast it to the great winepress of the wrath of God. God is wrath. God is judge. We also like to think about how good God is and how, you know, he just loves me as I am, and you're right, but also we have to understand what? He is the judge. And he does bless those that will serve him and honor him and worship him, but at the same time, he is what? Judge. And there is a wrath side of God. Those of you that are parents understand that, amen?
Amen.
As a parent, you understand there's a time to where you have to hug him and keep them close, and tell them you love them, and it's okay. And there's also a time to where you have to say, that was wrong, don't do that again. I mean it, don't you do that again. Don't you talk to me like that. Don't you talk to your father, or your mother, or your grandma, or anybody else like that. Or you'll pay. Don't you ever steal. Don't you ever cuss. Right? Fill in the blanks. You know there's a time as a parent where you have to be a boss. And to teach them what is right. And to put them in their place. God is not just going to spoil us and give us everything we want. That's not fair. I think of my kids. Okay? Some of you know what I'm talking about. My first one, man, that was hard. The 12-year-old, you can kind of tell. We're pretty hard on him. And then you see my little 4-year-old twin girls. Man, they get away with everything.
I wonder right? why.
You can tell those little girls are spoiled. And we're starting to pay for it. Yeah. We have one of the little 4-year-olds. Maybe we know which one I'm talking about. She will box you around if she gets a chance. And our new little phrase is, you're not queen. Okay? We have to be hard on her now because what? If we don't, she's just going to be a spoiled little brat. And just think she'd give her away. And is that how God wants us to be?
No. Yeah.
So God can't just be all lovey-dovey, gimme-gimme. He also has to be the parent who says, knock it off. If you don't knock it off, I'm going to punish you. And you're going to pay because you must do what is right. God is the judge. Revelation 15:3. And they sing the song of Moses, the servant of God, the song of the Lamb, saying, great and marvelous are thy works, Lord God Almighty, just and true are thy ways, thou King of saints. Talking about these words already, but God is just. He is right. He is true. And he is the King of saints. That's us. Those of us that are believers, he is the king. He is the boss. He is the one that we worship and praise. He is the King of saints. Sometimes people get trying to take God's place. No, no, no. Your boss is God. Some pastor's like, well, I'm a pastor. I had a pastor. He's not my friend anymore. He unfriended me on Facebook because I called him out. But he tried to be king of another church. He called out, he went publicly on Facebook and tried to call out some other church for what they were doing. He's not the pastor of that church, he's the pastor of his own church. But he tried to be the king of that church. You know what so many people told him? That's not your business. Right. Stay out of that church's business. God is in charge of that church. You are not. You go into your own little church and be the king of that church, I guess, whatever. No, that's not, listen, he's not the king of that church either. God is the king of the saints. That's why in this church, this ministry, I try to make sure I am in that. I'm not the one that's, you know, trying to be the boss of this ministry. I want to be the one that's the servant, that's ministering. Because I want who? Him to be the king of this ministry and the king of our lives. That we don't worship the pastor or worship some spiritual leader. We worship the king of us. And that is Jesus. And that is God. And the last one here. And they blasphemed the God of heaven because they paid their sores and repented not of their deeds. He is the God of heaven. What does that mean, Pastor Cody? Well, we know Satan is called the God of this world, little g, the God of this world. And above him is who? The God of heaven. What is heaven? Heaven is everything. It is creation. We would say he is the God of the universe. Satan has a little bitty hold on this earth. And yes, he's going to have some victories. But we know above that is the God of the universe, who created it all, who sustains it all, who's in charge of it all. And he's the one we pray to. And he's the one that has Satan under his thumb. And if we need help, we just call upon God, and he gives us that help and that strength, because he is the God of heaven. Satan may be the God of this world, and he's deceived billions of people today, but one day we know God's going to put him in his place, because he is the God of the universe. Finally, before we're done, the Spirit. Talked about Jesus, talked about the Father, and now we're going to look at the Spirit. John chapter 1, verse 4. John to the seven churches which are in Asia. Grace be unto you and peace from him which is, which was, which is to come. And from the seven spirits, you see that word is capitalized, meaning it's talking about God, the Spirit, which are before his throne. So first about the Spirit is seven spirits. And I think that that's word of perfection. The Bible uses the word seven as a completion. And so when we see this word seven spirits, it's talking about the completeness, that the Spirit is everywhere. The Spirit of God is at the farthest reaches of the galaxy. The Spirit of God is in heaven today. The Spirit of God is where? Those of us who are saved. The Spirit, it's everywhere. Folks, the Spirit of God today, if you are saved, is dwelling in your heart. Who's in your heart? God. God is with you. The Spirit, he that hath an ear, let him hear what the Spirit saith to the churches. The Spirit and the churches. I know in my own life, because I was raised this way as an independent Federal Baptist, it's like they forget about the Spirit. Talk about God a lot, talk about Jesus a lot, but man, they were so nervous to be labeled as Pentecostal that they wouldn't even talk about the Spirit hardly. And yet the Bible is so very clear, folks, that the Spirit of God is the one that works in the church today. Jesus says, I go to the Father, but I send my Spirit to you. And folks, it's the Spirit of God today that works and blesses in churches. And he's the one that we should be praying for, that the Spirit would show up, that he'd set our hearts on fire, that he'd revive us again. Yes, we pray to God. Yes, we pray to Jesus. But it's the Spirit of God today that's inside of you. And he's the one that needs to be encouraged and prayed for and uplifted so that we can have this power of the Spirit in our lives and in our church. And after 3 days and a half, the Spirit of life. Remember that capital word is, that word is capitalized. So it's talking about who? The Holy Spirit of life from God entered into them. And they stood upon their feet. And great fear upon them which saw them. The Spirit revives. The Spirit of God came upon these men, and they were back to life. Folks, today you may not be dead physically, but some of us this morning are dead spiritually. My friend, that's what I told my, he's not my friend anymore, he's unfriended. That's what I told the pastor. I said, the Spirit of God is closed off to you right now, because the Spirit of God would not lead you to say that about that pastor and that church. I said, the Spirit needs to speak to your heart. Because what's the fruit of the Spirit? Love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. That's the fruit of the Spirit. And none of what you said was any of that. It was hatred. It was animosity. It was destroying the brethren. And some of you this morning, that's your heart. Don't get in my way. Don't sit in my pew. You're just ready to fight. Some of you, that's your heart towards your neighbor. I can't wait to see what it is. Is that the spirit working in your heart?
No.
You know, some of you have cut off the spirit of God. And all you are critical and angry and frustrated and depressed and discouraged. Listen, that's because the spirit's not working. You are dead spiritually. Still going to heaven, still forgiven, but the spirit of God is not working. Some of you in a little bit need to pray for that spirit to be able to speak. Just like that pastor. I said, you need to pray for the Spirit of God to be at work in your heart because he's closed off to you right now. Some of you that are angered, that are frustrated, that are just so bitter and broken and divided, that's not the Spirit of God. That's Satan. And you need to ask Satan to take a hike, and you need to ask the Spirit to come in and to fill you with joy. And lastly, this morning about the Spirit, and I heard a voice from heaven, right, blessed are the dead which die in the Lord. From henceforth, yea, saith the Spirit, they may rest from their labors and their works that follow. And the Spirit comforts this morning. The Spirit of God is what's inside of us. That's what Jesus called him, the comforter. I thought that was the last one, but this is the last one. 22:17, and the Spirit and the bride say, come. And let the hearers say, come. And that what thirst come, and whosoever will let him take of the water of life, this water of life is salvation, freely. Folks, this morning, the Spirit of God convicts. It's the Spirit of God that moves in people's hearts to convict them of their sin and lead them to Jesus. And that brings us to our last passage of Scripture, Galatians chapter 5. Christ has become no effect. Whosoever are justified by the law, ye are fallen from grace. For we through the Spirit wait for the hope of righteousness by faith. This verse is talking about someone who's trying to get salvation by the works. They're trying to get saved by the deeds, by the church they go to, by the baptism, whatever. It says, you have no spirit working in you because you're trying to do it by works. But those that are saved are the ones that have the spirit working to get them to be saved by faith. The spirit convicts us. It shows us that we need salvation. And this morning, if that's you, if you feel the spirit of God pricking your heart saying, I need salvation. I need to be saved so I don't go to hell. Listen, that's the Spirit of God. In just a few minutes, we're going to spend some time in prayer. Pray and ask God to forgive you. And let the Spirit of God in, and you will have salvation. Folks, application. Jesus is needed for forgiveness. Number two, the Spirit is nigh. I have this passage of Scripture. I don't have time to read it, but I said it in my last passage. I don't want to lie to you a sixth time. John 14:26-27. Jesus says he's the comforter. He is with us. And finally this morning, God is everything that you need whenever you need it. Let's say that together. God is everything you need whenever you need it. Here's the list. Holy, true, faithful witness, first begotten of the dead, prince of the kings of the earth, loved us, washed us from our sin, the lamb, the lion, the root of David, the man-child, king of kings, lord of lords, the word of God, bright and morning star, the almighty, alpha and omega, who is, who was, who is to come. He is the creator, the wrath, the judge. He is just and true, king of saints, the God of heaven. The seven spirits, he is everywhere. The spirit of the churches, he revives, he comforts, he convicts. What is it you need this morning? And this morning again, what did I tell you at the beginning? That's just a sliver of a sliver of a sliver of who God is. He's so much more than those things. He's what you need when you need it today. So we're going to close in prayer. As we determine to make some decisions, in our prayer. These are the prayers that I believe I ask that you begin to pray for. Number one, if you're not saved, pray for Jesus to forgive your sin. The Spirit of God speaking to your heart, I'm not saved. I need salvation. Just ask for him to forgive your sins, and he will forgive your sins, and you will be saved. If you are saved this morning, pray for the Father to fill your empty spaces. Where is it that you're empty? What is it that you need this morning? He is your everything whenever you need it. Whatever your void is, wherever the devil's trying to fight you at, pray and ask God to fill that void. And number three, pray for the Spirit. Pray for the Spirit to help you be full of songs of praise. If you are depressed, if you are discouraged, if you are down, if you are angry, if you are frustrated, that's Satan, that's the flesh. Tell Satan to take a hike. Tell that discouragement, that depression, whatever to go. and ask the Spirit to again bring that joy in the songs of praise this week. And so let's just spend a few minutes of praise and prayer to God this morning.